Welcome to St. Patrick's. Thanks so much for joining us today for the liturgy. We're going to sing a special praise and worship song before we start. This is called Holy Spirit. There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. No thing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Catholic Mass here at St. Patrick's Catholic Community in Scottsdale, Arizona. I'm the pastor, Father Eric Tejas. To our parishioners, we're glad that you are tuning in today to keep the sacredness of the Sabbath and our connection to the Mass, the highest form of prayer in the Church, important in your lives during these days. And to any guests and visitors, we welcome you and glad that you are here to worship with us. On this, the fourth Sunday of the Easter season, we just look for a moment here that we have is what is called the Paschal Candle, and it's placed near the altar during these 50 days of Easter. We remember the word Paschal in Hebrew means Passover, that Jesus Christ passed over from death to life. So when we die spiritually or when we die physically, we will share in Jesus' death. And a death just like his, but we will also share in his resurrection. And so this Paschal mystery is celebrated at every Mass. So we remind you that because we want you to enter into praying. Again, like we talked about last week, the technology is great that the Mass can be brought to you. But if all it is that you watch, and you're lying in bed in the sense that you could get up and walk around and you kind of just there in a real informal way, that's kind of hard to engage in prayer. Even though we can't receive communion and even though we can't be here with each other, it is the highest form of prayer that is offered to God. And God listens to that. Because he's not limited whether we go to inside a church building or not. Wherever prayer is done is offered to God. So please respond to the prayers. You can sit and stand normally like you would do at any particular liturgy. But to know that let's give this time reverence, that it is prayer, that it is engaging. Remember, our church documents teach that liturgy is always full, active, conscious participation. And we thank you for tuning in, and we thank you for offering your prayers for the entire world this day. And so, Paul, our gathering song for this, the fourth Sunday of the Easter season, this liturgy.
We invite you to sing with us now. Christ is risen.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you.
And with your spirit.
In our first reading from the Acts of the Apostles, Peter is preaching a repentance and a belief in Jesus Christ. In the New Testament, repentance doesn't just mean turning away from a laundry list of sins. But it is a radical reassessment of who Jesus Christ is for us and whether our lives are modeling the way Jesus lived his life. For the times that our modeling has not been Christ-like or centered in Christ, let's call to mind our sins and repent and reform our lives into the model of the Good Shepherd, Jesus Christ. You were sent to heal the contrite. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You plead for us at the right hand of the Father. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us. Forgive us our sins and bring us all to everlasting life. Amen. Let us now join God's people throughout the entire world in the singing of the glory.
God in the highest, glory to God in the highest, glory, glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace to people of good will. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away. take away the sins of the world. Receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Have mercy on us. Glory to God in the highest. Glory to God in the highest. Glory, glory to God in the highest. And on earth, peace to people of good will. You alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High Jesus Christ. With the Holy Spirit in the glory of God the Father.
Let us pray. Gathering all our prayers into one, ever-living God, lead us to a share in the joys of heaven, so that the humble flock may reach where the brave shepherd has gone before, who lives and reigns with you in unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. Amen. At this time, let us now be attentive to the Word of God.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice, and proclaimed, "Let the whole house of Israel know for certain that God has made both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified." Now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart. And they asked Peter and the other apostles, "What are we to do, my brothers?" Peter said to them, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins. And you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is made to you and to your children and to all those far off, whomever the Lord our God will call." He testified with many other arguments and was exhorting them, "Save yourselves from this corrupt generation." Those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 persons were added that day. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
My shepherd, there is nothing I shall want. The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. In verdant pastures he gives me repose, besides restful waters he leads me, he refreshes my soul. The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want. He guides me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk in the dark,
valley, I fear no evil, for you are at my side with your rod and your staff that give me courage. The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want. Only goodness and kindness follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord for years to come. The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want. The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
A reading from the first letter of St. Peter. Beloved, if you are patient when you suffer for doing what is good, this is a grace before God. For this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his footsteps. He committed no sin, and no deceit was found in his mouth. When he was insulted, he returned no insult. When he suffered, he did not threaten. Instead, he handed himself over to the one who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body upon the cross, so that, free from sin, we might live for righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed. For you had gone astray like sheep, but now you have now returned to the shepherd and guardian of your souls. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said, "Amen, amen, I say to you, whoever does not enter the sheepfold through the gate, but climbs over elsewhere, is a thief and a robber. But whoever enters through the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens it for him, and the sheep hear his voice, and the shepherd calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has driven out all his own, he walks ahead of them, and the sheep follow him because they recognize his voice. But they will not follow a stranger. They will run away from him, because they do not recognize the voice of strangers." Although Jesus used this figure of speech, the Pharisees did not realize what he was trying to tell them. So Jesus said again, "Amen, amen, I say to you, I am the gate of the sheep for the sheep. All who come before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the gate, and whoever enters through me will be saved and will come in and go out and find pasture. A thief comes only to steal and to slaughter and destroy. I came so that they may have life and have life more abundantly. The Gospel of the Lord. People who work in advertising or marketing would probably tell you that the message and the way they message something is real successful if it's remembered for a long time. I remember when I was a 10-year-old boy, that's about 50 years ago, there was a commercial, a public service announcement that ran on many television stations. And it had a father and a son walking along, and the little son would do everything the father did. So the father walked a particular way. The son imitated his father. The father saw a rock and threw it against the lake and skipped it. The son tries to do the same. They go fishing, and he throws the line in, and the son does the same with his little fishing pole. And then he leans back against the tree, crosses legs, and puts his hands behind his head, and the son does the same exact thing. And then the commercial ends with the father grabbing a pack of cigarettes, ready to light it and smoke the cigarette. And the commercial stops there with the son reaching out and saying, "Your son sees everything you do. Is this what you want him to learn?" Wow. That's something I've remembered for 50 years. And I would say that advertisement worked well to be able to remember that for so long. And it's true that people are always watching us and learning from us. And the question we can ask ourselves is, what are we modeling? I think if there's one theme we can get from today's scripture readings, it's that what does Jesus model to us in shepherding, in leading, in caring for other people? In our first reading from the Acts of the Apostles, again, we mentioned last week, written by Luke, this is Pentecost, because this is chapter 2 now, and Peter is preaching boldly of Jesus Christ, and he tells the people of Jesus who was crucified, who was raised from the dead, and is now glorified. And so the people ask, well, what are we supposed to do now? And Peter says, repent, reform your lives. Again, repentance means not just turning away from a list of sins, but rather Peter is calling them to a radical reassessment of who Jesus Christ really is for them. Remember, in the early times after Jesus' death and resurrection, many people did not follow him because they thought, if he was really the Son of God, why would God allow him to be crucified and humiliated that way? What a failure. And that's why Peter is calling them and others to reassess who Jesus is for him, that he is not a loser, a failure, but rather he is the Son of God, glorified and next to the seat of the Father. Peter reminds them that in baptism, they then are incorporated into the community, but they are to model their lives after Jesus, not admire, not just sit back and go, wow, Jesus, that's a pretty neat thing you did. You are a special person. But that we are to model what Jesus does, and we are supposed to go also and to serve and lay down our lives for other people. In today's gospel, John uses the image of shepherd. He gets that from the Old Testament, as that image is used quite often. Around that time, too, New Testament writers are writing about the image of shepherd, but it many times is used for people who are leading different communities. But for John, he uses shepherd only for Jesus, and that Jesus is the model shepherd. Jesus, many times, is not happy with religious leaders of that day. And there are a number of parables in the scriptures, including this one, that again talks about his dissatisfaction and unhappiness with religious leaders at that time. And he uses the image of a shepherd. First of all, he calls himself the gate. In that ancient time, in the Middle East, all the sheep would be out about in the pastures, and then at night they would all be called into one fold. So all sheep would all come from different places and be put in by the shepherds. And then one shepherd was chosen to be the gate to protect from marauders and wolves and other such animals. And there's no metal gate that's there, but literally the shepherd would just lay down and become the gate that anyone of a robber, thief, or a wolf comes through the sheep. To get to the sheep, they have to go through the shepherd. And the shepherd literally lays down his life. In the morning, next day, the sheep would follow the shepherds. Now, most shepherds would tell you, people who do that for a living would say, you don't lead the sheep, you follow from behind, because if there's any strays, you make sure that you can get them. But in the Middle East, and including Jesus, the image that he uses, they hear the voice. It's more of a cry than a voice. It's a cry out that the sheep, who are weak and powerless, really, and when they're not very good at location. They don't know where they're at all the time. And if they get lost, they just usually fall down to the ground and cry out until the shepherd comes and saves them. And yet Jesus tells us that he is the good shepherd and that the sheep know him. Why? Because Jesus lays down his sheep and he knows them. He says the leaders of that time, many of them, only did it for themselves, for their own ego, for their own sense of power, for their own edification. And that's not what true leadership is about. So what do we learn? We learn then that anyone who takes on the role of leadership, and it isn't just religious people, but any Christian who's baptized is called to model the shepherding of offering one's life, of putting people first, knowing them. And that's not an easy thing for us at times. One of the things that I find about leadership is I've learned a lot over the many years as a priest, but also as a human being. One of my greatest joys is coaching football at a local high school in Phoenix, Arizona called Sunny Slope High School. And I've been doing that for about 12 seasons. And the reason I love coaching the kids is because they're not impressed with my title, Father. In fact, after 12 years, the only thing they said that was any good was, that's cool. That was it. Nobody oohs and ahs. It's usually the adults who are oohing and ahing, going, wow, a priest coaching? Wow, that's great. Kids, they couldn't care less. But each year, I had to earn their respect. It wasn't given to me. Oh, you're the coach, you're the priest, we'll listen to you. I had to be one of the first ones at practice. I had to leave on time from work here at church and to be sure I'm on time because we started off with special teams, the kicking game, every practice. I had to be prepared. I had to meet with the kids where they're at and to show up. And that's half the battle. I think the kids are not so much always interested in my knowledge and all, but did I really care about them? And if I showed up on time, I probably in 12 years, I think I've missed maybe 4 practices overall, because it was important to be there. I dressed the same way. I had the same pattern, because what I wanted the kids to know that they could count on me and forget about it. Oh, Coach Padre is there all the time. And I had to earn it each year. And over the course of the season then, over a meal or on the sidelines with practice, I got to know them a little more. And in that way, I could reveal what a priest is about or who I am personally. And I think all leaders really need to learn that it isn't just a given. Just because you wear a collar, just because you have the fancy title father or church minister in terms of a professional sense, doesn't mean you get automatic respect. Sometimes we have to keep earning it over and over. I always tell people, a priest like me is only good as your last homily. Huh? People can forget sometimes, huh? And that's okay. Because that reminds me what real shepherding is about, laying down the life for others. Where do you see that modeled right now in leadership of all kinds? Where do you see the modeling of Jesus the shepherd, of placing people first, knowing the sheep, and laying down the lives? Just like you, I am trying to figure out what's happening in our world and in our country and city right now. And I'm enjoying the discussions with different people in church ministry. And one of the things I think we're seeing now is moral theology talked about in a different way. No longer is it like in the abstract. No longer is it theoretical. Now, what if this happened? What if that happened? Moral theology is being lived out and affected every person right now. Who's leading us? Who's guiding us right now? Are people most important? Are their health? Or is it the economy? That's why debate is important, because first of all, who's expendable? They're old people. They're vulnerable. They take anyway. Let's take a risk. Let's just go out. Let's just live the life the way we normally would because they're infringing on our rights. But yet on the other side, I'm starving. How am I going to feed my family and pay rent? What am I supposed to do? And that's moral theology that's being lived out now, no longer talked about out there in space, and we can figure things out theoretically. It's happening now. And what do we want from our leaders? And what does Jesus model? And it isn't just for religious leaders. All Christians are called to model shepherding after Jesus. And so, how do you and I place people first? How do you and I give them dignity? How do you and I deal with people we disagree with and find it hard to love and accept in our lives? And that's really the modeling of shepherd that Jesus wants. Because be careful, people are watching you and me as Christians. And what are we teaching them? Just as the father reaches for the cigarette pack, the little boy is wondering, I want to be like my dad. I will smoke too. So if we're modeling poor leadership and only in it for ourselves and what we want and what we can get right now, that's what people are going to learn about Christians. But they also can learn good things, that we lay down our lives for others, that we serve others, that we too join Jesus in being the gate and saying, no one is going to harm anyone because they have to go through me, meaning you and me in leadership. That's why leaders need to be prayed for right now. Whether we agree with them or not, whether we like them or not, all leaders have to be prayed for. Let's pray for them that they can model Jesus the Good Shepherd, that they lay down their lives, that becomes their sole concern. The common good of all people.
The word of God has been proclaimed to God's people. That's the purpose of scriptures and broken open by today's homily. What ways can we, the people of God here at St. Patrick's, live our faith? A lot of people think, is there really any ministry going on at St. Patrick's right now? We're not able to gather. We're not able to get sacraments. We're not able to function as a parish that we're used to as well. And there is a lot happening right now. Almost all parishioners now should have received a call from our parish or an email or a letter, depending how we can get a hold of you. And we had 70 ministers here, parishioners like you, who were trained to call and check up on everyone. And we're getting great feedback of what some of the needs might be and getting a kind of a gauge with that as well. So first of all, every parishioner soon will have been contacted. We're near the end of that list. So that's an important ministry. Sandy Myers, our parish nurse there, is given important information. And here's what she's telling us, what some of the people are struggling with right now. There's an increase in addictions of all type. Wow. That's serious. Also, there are mental health issues that are coming out of this. Also those who are grieving, maybe the death of a loved one through the virus or a grieving of a loss of a job or of a family situation. But we're preparing right now and are offering resources and through Zoom technology and other forms of way of contacting people. So the church is working behind the scenes, even though we can't see that. That's all the important stuff that's happening as well. We're also reaching out to help groups come together to connect spiritually. We're also offering kits for all types of our youth, as well as the parents as well. And you know who's really grieving at this time? Our youth. You know, they've never experienced anything like this before. And our youth ministers are reaching out to them, but we have a great professional counselor who's going to be offering some podcasts. And she's worked with our youth many times and has given talks at our different places here. She's a great expert, but can talk to youth and parents and children. What are they going through right now? So the church is offering a lot right now. And right, usually the temptation is, and I think some churches across the country are seeing a decrease in the giving because people are saying, if I can't get sacraments, if I can't get a community, what are you doing? It's not worth giving. So if you're not aware of all the things that are still going on and the needs that are happening, just because we can't get sacraments now, just because we can't see one another now, doesn't mean nothing's happening. The needs are right now different than ever before. We can't be blind to that. So every gift you give, and you'll see that up on the screen at our offertory time, your gift matters to allow these things to continue. There's a lot of hurting people out there, and St. Patrick's is leading the way and trying to reach out, and we're learning as we go along and offering more. So other ways, again, that you can be involved with for adults, Alpha. It begins this week. Alpha will be conducted completely online. It includes a dynamic talk in small groups. It's a way of gathering people together to talk about faith, and I think an important thing, too, without being corrected. I think a lot of times we get scared, but it's a faith formation, a faith gathering, a spiritual enhancement as well, that really allows people to come to discover who God is for them. And so Alpha is available at no cost and is an important way to remain grounded in prayer and mission. The youth, Rock 45, the fourth and fifth graders, elementary, and the Edge Middle School ministries continue online on Monday nights. Special social programming for middle school students is offered online on Thursday afternoons and Friday evenings. And Life Teen High School ministry continues virtually on Wednesday and Sunday evenings. The youth can join in at any times, and all types of friends are welcome. Some are not parishioners, and some are not even Catholic, and they're part of that as well. So we'd encourage you to share that good information, especially for our youth. Each spring, St. Patrick's hosts a water drive, and we're encouraging everyone to participate in Water Light this year. Water Light applies donations toward the purchase of bottle waters at a discontinued price and that are delivered directly to the cooling station across the valley. And we ask you to help us reach our goal of 295,000 water bottles. And you can go onto our main page on our website to donate. And finally, do you miss Just Coffee? You can now order that from our website and enjoy free delivery to your home. Your purchase supports coffee growers and their families. Orders may be made on the parish website. You can also see the bulletin by downloading them and ask you to encourage you to support the sponsors of the parish bulletin. That really helps in need. Thank you for listening. Let us stand. Let us now profess our faith through the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. The homily called us to pray for all leaders. Whether we like them or their policies or not, the Holy Spirit needs to work with them. And so, given that authority to lead people, it's the call of every Christian to pray for every leader that their choices model the Savior Jesus of caring for all the sheep and laying down their lives for the common good.
For Pope Francis and all who serve and lead in the church, that they may follow the humble example of Christ, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our government leaders, that God will give them insight and courage as they develop plans to preserve the health and safety of society and to reopen the economy, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who are unemployed, that they will be connected to resources and new opportunities to use their gifts, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all in caring professions, that the Lord's compassion may be visible in them, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our St. Patrick Catholic community, that our ears will be attuned to the voice of the Good Shepherd, calling us to the fullness of life in the midst of this coronavirus pandemic, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who are suffering illness of any type, may the Lord restore their health and give them hope. Sue Lewis, Mary Taverdi, Cohen Baracco, Liz Healy. And for those who have died, that the Good Shepherd will welcome them into the fullness of life. Mary Hanley, Anne Grutzer, Johnny Doritas, Ed DeLong, Leona Nyleb, Fred Pope. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We now add our own intentions at this time to the Lord. Lord, gather all the prayers, those spoken and deep within the hearts of everyone present. Answer them always according to your compassionate way. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
And at this time, we now move to the offertory, the presentation of the gifts.
Shepherd, you lay down your life for us. Good Shepherd, your sacrifice beyond all price. Good Shepherd, listen as you call our name. Good Shepherd, you hear our cry. Shepherd, he knows his sheep. He calls to them and says, you are mine. Sheep who know the good shepherd, they recognize the shepherd. Good Shepherd,
Pray, my brothers and sisters, that this our sacrifice, the sacrifice of ourselves, may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church. Amen. Grant, Lord, that we may always find delight in these Paschal mysteries, so that the renewal constantly at work within us may be the cause of our unending joy. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us truly give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and salvation, at all times to acclaim you, Lord, but in this time above all, to laud you yet more gloriously when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. He is the true Lamb who takes away the sins of the world. By dying, he's destroyed our death. By rising, he's restored our life. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every person exults in your praise, and even heavenly powers with angelic hosts sing to glory the joy of your unending hymn of praise.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
You are indeed holy and to be glorified, O God, who love the human race and who always walk with us on the journey of life. Blessed indeed is your Son, present in our midst when we are gathered by his love. And when, as once for the disciples, so now for us, he opens the scriptures and breaks the bread. Therefore, Father most merciful, we ask you now to send forth your Holy Spirit. Sanctify these gifts of bread and wine, that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Before he was given up to death, a death that he freely accepted, he took bread and said the blessing. He broke the bread, giving it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat it. This is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, again giving you thanks and praise, giving it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, to be shed for you and for many for forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, Father, as we celebrate the memorial of Christ, your Son, our Savior, whom you led through his passion and death on the cross to the glory of the resurrection, and whom you've seated at your right hand, we proclaim the work of your love until he comes again, and we offer you this bread of life, this chalice of blessing. Bring your church, O Lord, to perfect faith and charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Thomas, our Bishop, his assistant bishop, and all who serve your holy people. Open our eyes to the needs of our brothers and sisters. Inspire us in words and actions to comfort those who labor and are burdened. Make us serve them truly after the example of Christ and at his command. And may your church stand as a living witness to truth and freedom, to peace and justice, that all people may be raised to a new hope. Remember our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the peace of Christ, and all the dead whose faith is known to you alone.
We offer the loss of our loved ones, including all the people throughout the world, whether known or not known at this moment, who have died from the virus. Admit them to rejoice in the light of your face, and in the resurrection give them the fullness of life. Grant also to us on our earthly pilgrimages done that we may come to an eternal dwelling place, to live with you forever, in communion with the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, Joseph, her spouse, the apostles, the martyrs, Saint Patrick, and all your saints. We shall praise and exalt you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever.
Amen.
Let us pray with confidence to the Father in the words that Jesus gives us.
Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is. Our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our day. By the help of your mercy, we may always be free from sin, safe from all distress and worry, as we wait in joyful hope for the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Whoever you're watching this with, if they're with you, or some people text one another, we just thank maybe people in our minds and hearts that we're missing or know that needs our love and peace now as we offer that sign of peace. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Happy are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord,
I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. May the body and blood of Christ bring us all to everlasting life.
Amen.
Thank you. peace I've come to know. Though my heart and flesh may fail, there's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when He calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise on eagle's wings before my God, fall on my knees and rise. I will rise. I will rise when He calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will
Let us conclude our prayer. Lord God, may today's word and sacrament guide our speech and actions of this week. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Thank you for all the great comments that we've received from you, being grateful for the Mass and other great comments of our ministry and outreach as well. That means a lot to us during this time, and we really appreciate that. We're trying to be as effective as possible. You're probably going to notice over time as we get better at this, more new things added to the Mass, just in terms of making that more engaging for you, make you more aware of what's happening. So we're increasing over time and doing even a better job on that as well. But it takes a whole team to do this, so I'm very grateful to all the people that have put in, our musicians and people behind the scene with Adam Stein and also Chad Carpenter with the sound and the staff that are present there. So it isn't just one person doing everything. There's a lot working behind the scenes. So your support, your prayers, everything that you do means a lot to allow this Mass to come online and touch many lives. The Lord be with you.
And with your
spirit. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
God.
Let the people say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. God so loved the world that He gave His only Son. Whoever believes in eternal life.
world.